Good afternoon, everybody. Hi, welcome back. Hope everyone enjoyed the home team activity and the breakouts. I know I've already made some great new connections. I hope you have too. I'm particularly thankful for my commitment companion, Ashley Weaver from the Waco Foundation. So I hope you found someone great to be your commitment companion too. So we now have the privilege of hearing from two philanthropic leaders who have baked collaboration into the DNA of their organization over a good period of time. Ashley Snowden Blanchard is a trustee and family member of the Hill Snowden Foundation, and Nat Williams is the executive director. And the Snowden Foundation has for decades focused on promoting social justice in communities throughout the US in a collaborative way. Now, Nat and Ashley would probably, neither of them would characterize themselves as experts, they'd characterize themselves as learners. But over the course of our conversations in the lead up for this, I know that we all in this room have a lot that we can learn from the deliberate and deep and long-term approach they've taken to setting themselves up as a collaborative organization. Now, Ashley is the great-granddaughter of the founder of the Hill Snowden Foundation. Arthur Hill is his name. But her commitment to philanthropy extends even beyond her board service. She is, in her day job, the Associate Director of Philanthropy at TCC Group, a GEO member, and I know we have some other TCC Group colleagues in the room. And Ashley's also on the Ms. Foundation board, so she has lots of different touch points in philanthropy. Now, Nat is the Executive Director, and he comes from a youth organizing background. So at the foundation, he's responsible for programs and operations, and you know it's a pretty tight staff, so it's basically everything, including probably you know cleaning out the bathroom sometimes, potentially.
That was the first 2 years.
The first 2 years. You're always glad when you get through that phase of startup, I can tell you that. But Nat's also been involved recently in creating a grantmakers for Southern Progress, which is a group of grantmakers who are working on social justice in the U.S. South. So there's many different layers of collaboration baked into his experience and to his work. So we're going to talk about how institutionally we build a culture of collaboration, how it is that we live and operationalize the values that are back on that wall and that we've been talking about, values like openness and trust, putting the work before ego, all of those kinds of things that are easily said and it's difficult to do. So I hope all of you will join the conversation, both by tweeting or also we're gonna have mic runners. I'm gonna ask these folks some questions, but I wanna get you into the conversation quickly. So Andy and Jason are on either end of the room. As soon as you have a question, raise your hand. I might not see you immediately, but we'll get you guys in as quickly as we can. So with that, I welcome Nat and Ashley, and thank you so much for sharing with us. Nat, I'm gonna start with you. So can you talk a little bit about the values that underlie the foundation's work?
Sure, and I just wanna start by saying we are so honored and appreciative to be invited to speak here at GEO's conference, and it's even cooler because you have the collaboration conference. I love the logo, the two C's going towards each other, but we really appreciate the opportunity to share some of our experience, and as Kathleen said earlier, we don't see ourselves as experts, but as learners along an ongoing path. And so, although this is a collaboration conference, we actually don't use the word collaboration that much. I know it's a shock. we use partnership more, but the way that I think the definition of collaborative is being developed today, it really overlaps with what we're talking about. So to us, a partnership is the practice of relationship and community building that is ongoing, evolves over time, and has its own intrinsic worth. And so often when you get together in collaborative, it's to achieve something, it's to do something really specific. And that's true of the partnership too, the way we think about it. But on the relational level, the goal of a partnership is to deepen the quality of the relationships that you have with your partners, such that when an opportunity presents itself or a new need comes along, you can respond quickly, you can respond effectively, and you can respond hopefully within a similar basis of values. And this value that we try to inculcate through all of our work in so many different ways. So for instance, when we talk to our grassroots partners, we don't say grantees, mm-hmm. we say grassroots partners, and our funder partners, we talk about developing political partnerships. A political partnership that, with a small p, that's based on this ideal of having a common ambition to co-create in a fair and just society. So that's one of the kind of foundations in terms of our partnership. But partnership to us, as you said, is baked into our DNA. Mm-hmm. We try to deal with this in so many different ways. And for us, it's a matter of both practicality and principle. On the practicality side, there's this great Ethiopian proverb. And it goes, when spiders' webs unite, they can tie up a lion. And when you think about our work that we try to do in all of our foundations, we are really trying to tackle some huge, complex, many times ferocious issues in terms of their intractability. And we have to see that in relation to that, you know, we're trying to wrestle lions when we are but just spiders. Non-venomous spiders, I should add. Even if some of us are really big spiders, we're still spiders. And so in order, if we really want to be effective, if we want to effectively address these issues, if we want to win, we really need to join forces to not only try to win, but also to try to share our resources, our talents, and our overall abilities so we can move things forward. And if you just give me one more second. If I could just have one more second. More than 1 second.
That's the song.
So that's part of it on the practical level. But on the principle level, the Hill Snowden Foundation supports community organizing as our core strategy. And the principal part of us, our commitment to partnership, is really based on this fundamental belief in the practice of community organizing as a transformative process for social change. And we try to live out these principles in as many different ways as we can. So I'm just going to talk about some of the principles. The first is a respect, and they reflect a lot of the principles we've talked about in terms of collaboration. A respect for and a reliance on the leadership of those who are most directly affected. They are our teachers, they are our leaders, they are our heroes and cheeros. And so we start from that place. Adopting a contributional rather than an attributional approach to change. Which is key. We're just part of a larger system. Taking risks and being bold and courageous. Community organizers day to day, on a daily basis, that is their business. Taking risks to try to create sometimes unforeseen change. Increasing accountability from decision makers around decisions. And so we feel that I'm definitely accountable to Ashley and other trustees. But we feel our core responsibilities. Both to the communities and to the groups that we support. And then finally, understanding that change is a process of co-creation with others. And so it's not just us, and it's not just folks in the community, it's us together trying to figure out how to best achieve the goals that we want to achieve. And so we try to embody that in several different ways in our work, and we'll talk a little more about that today.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Ashley, do you want to say anything else about how collaboration became such a cornerstone of the organization's agenda, and then maybe how that connects to what you were looking for when you hired Nat?
Sure. I'll maybe go back to talk about how we came to be, to embody the values that Nat talks about. We are a multi-issue, multi-generational community organizing funder. We have with a mission to create a just and equitable society that enables low-income communities to thrive, and we have assets of about $35 million. So collaboration is going to be baked into everything that we do because that's the kind of work we support, and our theory of change is really predicated on this idea that to create the world that we want to see, people will have to work together across issues, across audiences. So that was not where we started, though, in 1958 when my great-grandfather started this foundation. And really for the first 40 years, we were very much a traditional kind of kitchen table family foundation, very charitable checkbook philanthropy, where we had for the first really three generations, the typical controlling trustee model, first my great-grandfather, my grandmother, then my dad, who were basically running the show, including others here or there, but we weren't there was nothing terribly collective or collaborative about how we operated. And then in the mid to late 90s, you had a few different confluence of a few different factors. My grandmother passed away. The market was doing incredibly well, so our assets increased significantly. And partly in response to that, the third generation decided that they would include my generation, the fourth generation, who were then in our teens and early 20s. And I think at the time, they primarily just needed manpower. There was literally just too much money to give away the way that they'd been doing it with, you know, writing checks here or there to organizations that they knew. So you had this like trifecta of change catalysts and family philanthropy that happened. And so there was this agreement, and I remember these early meetings that were held literally around the kitchen table where people said, what if we started to operate differently? What if instead of like our little personal stuff, we actually focused on something? You know, we're never gonna be huge, but we could actually move the needle on an issue if we could pick something to focus on. And we realized that would require letting go of everybody's personal stuff. This is no longer gonna be the well that you dipped into for, you know, that organization you're on the board of or your kid's private school. And it meant that we were gonna have to come up with something together. There wasn't an obvious sort of issue that the whole family was united around. And we started working at that time in the late 90s with the Tides Foundation, established a donor advised fund there, and we needed both administrative and strategic help. And so in that sense, we were really kind of reborn in this collaborative model because we were, you know, one of many donor advised funds at Tides working with program staff who were working with other funders. So in a number of very informal ways, we got the benefits of this collaboration. I mean, I was at the time living in the Bay Area, so would go to a number of funder briefings and site visits with other funders and learned from others and collaborated often informally with others, participated in some more formal funder collaboratives. I think that experience really informed our values about the kind of funder we wanted to be and the value of working with others. Programmatically, you know, I said we were trying to find this niche, and we started off funding youth development, pretty traditional youth service organizations, because that's sort of a number of grantees we'd had in the past fit that bill, and you know, who doesn't like kids, right? It was sort of an easy, low-hanging fruit area. And we increasingly got exposed through Tides to a number of organizations that were doing sort of this additional youth development plus. They had this organizing component that we were really attracted to and gravitated towards. And at the time, youth organizing was a kind of nascent field, not that young people hadn't been organizing for, you know, hundreds of years, but the funders seemed to be catching on to the value of youth-led social change. So there were a few funders who were starting to think about, you know, how we could build a field or collective action among funders of this. So we sort of jumped into the fray there. And, you know, again, it was a niche, but even in that niche field, we were small compared to some of the others out there. And I think the thing we really realized through this whole experience was the power of our voice, even as a, you know, relatively small funder, new to the field. We found pretty early on that we could actually influence the field, influence how others acted by serving as a connector, by serving as a, you know, learning peer and resource to the field. We got engaged and actually started two funders collaboratives around youth organizing with others, not on our own, but collaboratively. We were, you know, one of the lead funders in these two funding collaboratives. And we had some early experiences where it was clear that, you know, we were able to leverage dollars from much larger foundations because we were seen as having some expertise and some knowledge on this in this field. So it was very exciting. I mean, I think early on we kind of got that our dollars were never going to be huge, but if we worked with others, both with funding peers, but also with our grassroots partners, we could affect change much larger than our size.
So fast forward to when you were looking for Nat.
Right.
And what were, you know, what was different about how you wanted to shape that role, about who the guy was, you or man or woman that you wanted in the chair?
So I think, so in 2004, 2005, we realized that if we really wanted to have this greater impact, we needed our own identity, decided to go out on our own and hire our own staff. And at that point, we were pretty clear and intentional about the model that of the foundation we wanted to be. And we knew Looking at my notes here, but there were a few things we knew. We knew we wanted to have a focus, sort of this niche, and we would need to have some in-house expertise. We were not looking for a family foundation administrator. We had no interest in that. We knew we were going to be doing more than just making grants. We had already seen the value of things like research and collaboration. We wanted to build the capacity of this nascent field of funder support for youth organizing. We knew we wanted to be a particular kind of grant maker. We wanted to make long-term, responsive general operating grants. And we knew that collaboration was going to be key to all of that. Again, you know, we're funding multi-issue, multi-generational organizing. We were going to need someone who shared those values, who could work collaboratively with their peers, work collaboratively with our grantee partners. And I think, you know, you mentioned in the report, which is wonderful, that you need to be clear about who you are and what you bring to the table. And I think we recognize that as a small family foundation, we didn't necessarily bring the dollars, but we brought nimbleness and flexibility and an openness and willingness to learn that had value in the mix. And so when we were looking to hire Nat, we were looking for someone, or not Pat, Nat, looking to hire our first executive director. We were looking for someone who shared those values and looking for someone who had relevant experience. He'd been working in youth organizing in his philanthropy in his prior job. And you know, we're also a family foundation, so the fit was gonna be, just the personality fit was critical. And I think we all sort of met Nat and said like, ah, he gets us. He can he can be in the room in some, you know, when it gets it gets familial.
Well, clearly they're familial because as we were walking back to get mic'd up, there was a spontaneous Nat's arm around Ashley for some little inside joke. I don't know what it was. So clearly you guys have built your trusting relationship. Do you want to say anything else, Nat, about like how you negotiated, what your role is
with
the board?
Well, actually, I don't remember the job description, but I didn't remember the collaborative piece in it, so I'm glad that I worked out all right. So it's been 11 years since I've been the executive director at Hill Snowden. And as Ashley said, we transitioned from the Tides Foundation being managed by then, so it was basically opening up a new office. So I was the only full-time staff person, and then quickly we hired two part-time staff people. And I was tasked with this task of developing our personnel policies. And so, you know, based on my former partnerships, I was begging, borrowing, stealing, you know, different aspects of personnel policies from several different foundations. But I wanted to create something that was key and that was met the demands of our current staff. So, and then we also were driven by this ideal that if you're a social justice organization and you had the resources, what would the personnel policies for a social justice organization look like? So we developed something that we termed called people first personnel policies. And it is just that. It's not putting the organization first. It's saying, how can you invest in people so that they can not only have a good work-life, family-life balance, but they can feel nurtured in their space. And I'm going to talk a little bit more in a second about it. But the main thing that I think is really at the core of our relationship, family or otherwise, is this just amazing amount of trust that the board showed in me. I thought like I had a year to get a whole bunch of things through, you know, the honeymoon period. But my honeymoon's still been going on, you know, for 11 years.
11
and
years
so
in,
it's great. And I think that trust is the foundation that you have to build on for any partnership and collaboration. And so we developed these people first personnel policies, and it was grounded in this ideal, at least part of it, that we wanted to support our staff. Many of the staff members, I didn't have children at the time, but our other two staff members did, and they were part-time, and they chose to be part-time so they could spend more time with their families. And so we were like, okay, let's figure out how to get the foundation to pay for supporting and extending benefits to part-time staff, which wasn't the norm at the time, and also to pay for family development. So that was part of what we tried to focus on. The other thing that I think is important in terms of as we built up our staff was making sure that we were not siloed internally. So we have now three program areas. It was youth organizing, economic justice organizing, and the Fund for DC, which we developed. And we hired up so that we had program staff people for each one of those positions. Mm-hmm. But we all took a portion of each other's portfolio. And when we have our program staff meetings and we all talk about and share what's going on across, and so that we are not just singly focused in our work. And that extends also to the rest of the organization. So we try not to have false barriers between board and staff. Mm-hmm. And so we have different committees. Every staff member is welcome to participate on any of the board committees. We try to cultivate relationships between board and staff outside of me, so I'm not the broker mm-hmm. of relationships. Mm-hmm. And again, I think these are all part of the internal aspect of emulating what we want to see out in the world, these deep partnerships mm-hmm. built on trust and relationships that have their own ability to develop as they mm-hmm. will.
So is there anything, Ashley, in your mind that that this different role for the foundation leader has enabled for Nat to do, for the foundation to become, that you think wouldn't have been possible if you'd been thinking a little bit more traditionally?
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned we saw pretty early on the benefits of collaboration. So in a few ways, I think early on we participated in a funder collaborative that was around living wage campaigns mm-hmm. through the Tides Foundation. And you know, our grant was pretty small, and overall this collaborative effort mm-hmm. wasn't huge, but it was happening at a time when there was a fair amount of traction on living wage campaigns. And so we saw that our contribution to the collaborative and the collaborative's contribution to the movement was actually having an impact. Mm-hmm. So I think that was really exciting. So yeah. It was an early introduction to collaboration. And similarly, with some early experiences where we had large national funders mm-hmm. pick up the phone and call, you know, either the program officers we'd been working with at Tides or call Nat and say, you know, what do you guys think? And then leverage dollars mm-hmm. to support youth organizing or a particular grantee was super exciting for us. So I think our early ideas around this were pretty narrowly about leveraging additional mm-hmm. resources. But they made us as a board recognize the value of those networks and relationships that are established. So when we were thinking about our staff and what we envisioned them doing, it was never gonna be on a, you know, the grant docket treadmill. Mm-hmm. It was, we wanted them out and about in the community building those relationships. And to be clear, we pay for that, mm-hmm. right? Like we value mm-hmm. it, and it is reflected in our budget. So if you look at our budget, our staff to grants ratio is relatively high, and that's intentional because we want our staff writing op-eds and serving on affinity group boards and being part of the field, contributing to the field, learning from the field. And you know, when they break their staff time in our budget, it's reflected in grant making, administration, and then what we call leverage, but it's all the other programmatic work they do in support of our mission. The second thing that I would mention is that this transition that I mentioned when we became much more focused and strategic also was brought about by a change in our governance. So we went from this single controlling trustee model where, you know, we had a series of trustees at the helm to a much more collaborative governance structure. So when the third generation said, let's make this be something radically different, that also extended to how we work together as a board. So at the time I was 26, I became the board chair. We felt like for funding youth organizing, we should, you know, walk the talk. But we are truly an organization where I think, and Nat, correct me if I'm wrong, there's no one voice on the board that's louder than any other. And I don't know if we would be able to operate in the collaborative way we operate internally and externally if we didn't live that mm-hmm. at the board level. And I think to the extent, you know, I can be honest about it, I think we do work very collaboratively mm-hmm. with the staff. I mean, I think the staff feels relatively comfortable speaking up mm-hmm. in meetings, and you know, we all have a voice, and I think everybody feels pretty heard.
It's mm-hmm. totally fascinating. I mean, just when you're thinking about that collaboration from the inside out, you know, there's a lot of small bits that you're talking about that you've put together that enables you to be, you know, the collaborative organization that you're trying to be. So now let's talk a little bit more about collaborating with other funders. I know that you're in the midst of a couple things along those lines, both with the Grantmakers for Southern Progress and the Black Lives Matters, which we haven't talked about yet, but maybe you can say a little bit about that whole experience.
So I'll talk deeply about that in a second. Well, I just want to say structurally, like I said, we had three program areas. Now we have a new initiative, the Making Black Lives Matter initiative. And in each one of our grant-making program areas, we have a complementary or corresponding leveraging aspect to it. So with youth organizing, we, as Ashley was saying, helped to start, and I was on the board of the Funders Collaborative for Youth Organizing co-chair for about 10 years. with the Economic Justice Program area, we work really closely with the Neighborhood Funders Group and our other program staff. Shona has played leadership roles within the Working Group on Community Labor Partnership. Mm-hmm. At the Fund for DC, we helped to create something called a Greater Washington Social Justice Forum. And all these were funder collaborative to try to generate more support and provide a network and space for folks. And then most recently, what we're pretty excited about, and I actually think it's a really great example of how our investment in the quote soft time of building partnerships amongst the board, amongst with our grassroots partners, with other funders partners, paid off. So we were particularly as a foundation, and specifically me, as a black man and as a black man within philanthropy and as executive director, was really inspired and moved and compelled to want to try to do something around the new light, the new night that was being shown on the conditions that were facing black people in this country, particularly as it relates to structural racism, and more specifically as it related to policing. And so I wanted to do some writing on that. I wanted to try to figure out how we could have a specific voice. One of our values is racial justice and gender justice, but we were never really particularly out there on that. It was kind of baked into all of our work, but we weren't particularly vocal about it. So I thought this was a key moment to be vocal. And I went to the board and I was like, well, you know, I want to do something about this. I'm going to do something about this. Just want to let you know. And they were like, hey, you know, it's way past time. We need to do this. And so in trying to develop this paper originally I wrote called Making Black Lives Matter, I had dinners with black organizers around the country where we just talked about the issues that they were seeing, about what was going on the ground. And that worked its way into this broader analysis that I had been working with other funder partners for a while, that looked at over the last 30, 40 years, our observation was that the support for in the philanthropic sector for black-led social change organizations was definitely declining, to the degree that now we had a malnourished, just in terms of funding, sector, which constricted the leadership pipeline that you need to really have strong black social change efforts and organizations. And so we were looking at that for a number of years, and when this moment came up, we wanted to try to figure how to do something about that. So the initiative that we developed, the Making Black Lives Matter initiative, it's focused on trying to support black-led organizing. The foundation was kind of almost like an auctioneering type of thing. So I wrote the paper, but we didn't have any resources, at least at the time, to do anything about this. We just had our voice until Ashley put something forward. I don't know if you want to talk about that process a little bit.
Sure. So Nat had written this great piece that was getting out there and getting some attention, but we weren't actually, I was going to say we weren't doing anything. That's not true. A lot of the organizations we were supporting were indeed, you know, black-led social change organizations, but we weren't doing anything in addition. Mm-hmm. And I happened to be at council last spring when Baltimore blew up. And, you know, it's kind of a room like this, and we're all sort of wringing our hands, like, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? And we have some grantees in Baltimore, and, I don't know, we feel somewhat connected being D.C.-based and family that lives in Maryland. And I went back to the hotel room, and I was packing to get on the airplane, and flipping through the channels, and the coverage is so awful about the like animals tearing apart their city, and it was just terrible. But then I clicked on some better station, and they were interviewing these three young men who were just awesome.
Everyone liked that little aside.
Sorry. But these guys were great. They were so wonderfully on message and eloquent about the challenges and how deeply they cared about their community. And I was thinking, like, who's doing their media training? Like, we just need to get whoever these guys are working with some money. Like, we just, right now, because we can do that. Like, we can do that quickly. So I emailed from, thank God for Wi-Fi on the airplane, I emailed the board and just said, like, this is, we need to go deep. We need to spend more money because we don't actually have it in the grant budget, but this is what we get to do as a small family foundation, is just make stuff up as we go along. So I had, at the time I'd thrown out, I wanted it to be six figures, because that for us is pretty sizable. Mm-hmm. So I'd thrown out, let's just get $100,000 out the door to Baltimore right now. And I had no plan, right? This was just like, we need to spend money. And then I think we got on the phone a few days later, the executive committee, and which is my dad, my sister, and I. And my sister was like, let's double it. Let's, you know, what about $200,000? This is all, you know, this is based in nothing, yeah. Really. And my dad was like, hey, let's triple it, but let's do it over 3 years. So how about like $1 million?
Right. And I was like, sold. Right.
And that was, you know, so we were building, we had such faith in Nat, like we had the groundwork laid here. We didn't know what this was gonna be, but we knew, and the reason it could happen the way it happened, as quickly as it happened, and I think within a few days we were, you know, had a board call, and the board was like, great, let's do it. This is a 20% increase in our grants budget. Like, this is gonna have a significant effect on our, you know, the lines, our financial projections are gonna go a little bit more like that for some foreseeable future. And we were able to operate nimbly and flexibly because we're small. We had total faith in Nat that, like, he would come up with something that would make sense, because we knew he had the networks and the connections and the credibility in the field. But for us, it was also because we were so clear on our mission and the fact that this was a mission moment for us. This is in keeping very much with our mission to create a just and equitable society in which low-income communities can thrive. Like, this was a time that called for us to go deep, and very much clear on the value that we are not in the business of endowment preservation. We all were on board with that.
I think that's an applause line.
So, you know, while we, we're spending a lot more than 5%, and everyone agreed, like, yes, this is a time that calls for us to do that. But we were clear on those values from the outset, so that we didn't have to have this big debate about, like, what's our policy to do this? Like, we do it because now's the time for us to do it.
Right.
It's amazing.
And if I could just say a couple
of
things.
Course.
So between the time we had the executive committee meeting and our board, it was 2 weeks. So I had 2 weeks to come up with a plan to basically, you know, save the black nation or whatever. But, so realizing that, I went and I talked to my partners. I talked to our colleagues, our grassroots partners, our funder partners, and in 2 weeks, we came up with a broader plan. And so there was a couple different parts of it. Again, it started in to some degree sparked by Baltimore, as you were saying, right? In terms of the actual impetus, the catalyst. But we said, look, you know, this is Baltimore, Ferguson, the last year is happening within a broader context that is many, many decades, many, many centuries long, right? And but our piece of that has to do with that, about building the infrastructure for black institutional and political power so that we can actually create the environment, create the opportunities, and create the real power to not just make black lives matter, but also to create opportunities where the black community can thrive. And while the issue right now is based on policing, you know, black lives don't matter across a whole range of different issues. So we wanted to make sure that we were focusing on infrastructure building that not only tapped into the current issue of the moment, but also looked at this what we at least saw as a kind of a pattern of underinvestment that weakened the ability for the Black community to struggle on anything. Mm-hmm. And so the $900,000 was important, but the frame that we adopted was important as well. And so focusing on Black-led organizing groups, strategic convenings, and intermediary, and building that capacity across five issues. So criminalization, which does include policing, but also looking at economic justice, particularly as it relates to jobs, looking at public housing, and affordable housing, looking at public education, and also voting and accountable governance. So that's the frame we have. And so, $900,000 is a drop in the bucket, according to, based on some of these issues. Mm-hmm. So we also knew we had to partner in order to really make the most of this moment. So we developed a partnership with the Association of Black Foundation Executives to create what we're now calling the Black Social Change Network. And it's really bringing together funders who have maybe been similarly moved in the moment or have been doing this work for some time to better align, coordinate, and collaborate in terms of our grant making so that we can be strategic in our work. Mm-hmm. But then broader than that is to really advocate for more resources for rebuilding, re-energizing this infrastructure for Black institutional and political power. And we don't see this as happening just within this space, right? Mm-hmm. What our real goal is to try to figure out how whatever foundation you have, whatever mission you are, that you have, that there is some focus on increasing the opportunities for dismantling some of the structural barriers that are preventing and prohibiting Black communities to thrive. And that is the real message, and that is not something that we can do by ourselves. Mm-hmm. And more importantly, that's not something that we should do by ourselves. And so that's why we're trying to figure out how to move this forward. Mm-hmm. And we're having our first meeting on December 10th, and I'll tell you more about that later. we're really excited about that, and that also is another part of the work that we've been trying to do around Grantmakers of Southern Progress. Again, looking at a place in the South where there is a need to have greater investment for social change, but it's been abandoned for several years. Mm-hmm. We wanted to highlight that with our partners, with other folks, to say that we really do need to reinvest if we're going to try to move an agenda for progressive change forward in this country.
That's fantastic. Well, I want to invite everyone else. I've got lots more questions for these people, but I just want to ask anyone in the room who has a question to signal Andy or Jason. And while you're doing that, I'm going to ask one more of Ashley before you guys hop in. So Ashley, you said one little thing in your whole description of how you got to that decision, which was that I had not realized until now that your dad is still on the board.
Yeah.
And so this is significant to me because what she just mentioned before is that the way that the board had operated previously is in this sort of hierarchical, where there was sort of a chair, and it was your dad at a certain point. And so somehow he made this conversion, or you guys helped him convert from being in a, kind of sole power player position to quite a collaborative. So is there anything you can tell me? Is he just magical, or is there anything that you can tell me about how that happened?
I mean, I can't talk about the foundation and that transition without giving some serious props to the third generation, which is my dad, aunt, and his two siblings, aunt and uncle, for really being authentic and meaning it when they said, we're gonna share power. And the more time I spend in this field, the more I realize how unique that is. And I think they wanted this to be a truly collaborative family foundation. And, I was like in high school at the time that this change was happening. Mm-hmm. I didn't really have any skin in the game, right? But for them, who'd been operating this as a very sort of their own personal discretionary thing, there was a lot to lose.
Of course there was.
My dad will sort of joke now about how we got involved and like slapped his hand out of the kitty, but that's kind of what happened.
He is still feeling the loss a little bit.
a little bit. But I think
that makes me feel like he's more human.
That's he's definitely human. I think that they realized that there was going to be this trade-off. Mm-hmm. If we really were going to have an impact, we couldn't operate that way anymore. And if we really wanted this to be a true collaborative family institution, we couldn't operate that way anymore. And I don't know why they like got that memo and lived it, but you know, kudos to them for doing it and meaning it. I mean, they didn't just say like, hey, you guys can come and sit in. They said like, so what
should
yours
look like?
Yeah, that's amazing. Well, you need to go back and get a little bit more of the oral history on that one, because I think there's lots of people, inquiring minds want to know out here how that got done. So Andy or Jason, just tell me if you've got someone with a question who has raised their hand, because I can't really see you. Oh, there we go. Thank you.
It's better.
Oh, there's Andy. No one has raised their hand yet. I'm going to keep asking questions until you do. I just figured that that people are probably chomping at the bit to get in this conversation. Someone is.
It's a very small bit right now.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Andy.
Just wanted to thank you both for sharing your wisdom. It's been great to hear you. Nat, could you talk a little bit more about the kind of fake line between staff and board that you had mentioned earlier? I wanted to learn a little bit more about that, about how that came about.
Sure. So without mentioning the other two foundations I worked at, but you could look at my bio, find out who they are. You know, when staff came to, staff did all the work, right? You know, we did all the site visits, we reviewed all the stuff, then we got into the board meeting and we just had to be quiet until called on. And it just felt really just weird. And also beyond that, it didn't really engage the board in a way that deepened their own understanding of the issues, right? And so when I was put in the position of structuring the conversations, you know, around this ideal of partnership, is like we have to hear from, learn from, and experience and engage, you know, the full breadth of knowledge. And so that's why, but it can't just be around programmatic work. And so that's what usually happens. Like, okay, yeah, you come in, you can talk about the programmatic work. When we have our staff meetings, we talk about administrative stuff. We talk about finance. We talk about program. When we have our staff, when we have the different committees, like I said, you have to, in order to look for the opportunities that could best move an organization forward, you have to be fully immersed in all the aspects of that organization. And so, yeah, I mean, like we try to figure out different ways, and I think it's easier too as a family foundation, because that's what we are fundamentally, and it's about cultivating family. But that means building relationships of trust. It means sometimes sitting in refereeing around some difficult things, but it's again, it's we wouldn't be able to have that. I think an earlier session today was kind of, you know, being able to live with the tension and the moments of complexity without having that based on a real relationships. So we're not asked to leave the room. We realize that we all have to be a part of the room. So I don't know if that helps, but it has really, I think, strengthened us as an organization. And I'll say it again, we would not have been able to move in the moment as quickly as we did with this last initiative if it hadn't been not just for the trust, but that trust built on 10 years of relationship building and deep relationship building.
And I would just add, I think from the perspective of the board, that with such a capable, excellent staff who do spend so much of their time on the ground in conversations with our grassroots partners, there's this question for us of how do we get engaged in the work in a way that is meaningful, respectful, will enable us to be good stewards and inform strategy decisions, but not, you know, not do the job of staff. So we really look to our grassroots partners, as Nat said, as our primary like learning vehicle. We rely on them through a range of mechanisms to let us know what's going on the ground, how we can best support their various work. And so for us, staff play a very critical role and sort of the conduit often in those relationships to hear from our partners and kind of feed that back to us, and then also to directly connect us with those partners. So I think part of the role of staff and board and line between board and staff is that really it's our grassroots partners who we are all trying to learn from.
Mm-hmm. Right. And I'm sorry, just one other thing. So we try to break down the kind of these false barriers between staff and board, but also the false barriers just as people being people, mm-hmm. between board and our grassroots partners. Mm-hmm. And so we have, the board does site visits. We all do group site visits every year. We've done that since I've been there, I think preceding that as well. But we also have experimented with different ways of board members developing their own personal relationships with the groups. And so we've been doing this board buddy process in the last year where, you know, the board members pick two or three groups that that's going to be their buddy. And we're going to do site visits together. We're going to make sure that they get, board members get updates mm-hmm. on their work as it goes forward, and in effect become experts not just on the work mm-hmm. but deepening their own relationships, and so we try, and sometimes it works, sometimes it mm-hmm. doesn't, but this constant drive towards developing authentic relationships mm-hmm. as the main currency, not just our not just the money, mm-hmm. but the main currency that we operate under is really key to us.
Can I add one more thing?
Go, sure.
Of course. I mean we got into this work, into community organizing and youth organizing, from a more traditional like youth development perspective. Mm. And I think for us, I said, you know, youth development plus, mm-hmm. but the reason that we got excited about doing this kind of work is because we saw the individual change. So the young people or community mm-hmm. members becoming organizers and how they would personally change, as well as the ripple effect mm-hmm. on the community. And it's deeply personal, and it's very much about relationships. Mm-hmm. We've been funding some of these organizations for a decade or more, and for us to remain engaged and passionate about the work, we need to see both kinds of change mm-hmm. happening. So we need mm-hmm. to get out there and meet the community leaders. I mean, we've, you know, had people cook us meals in their home. Like, it's mm-hmm. a very deeply personal kind of work we support, and it's totally based on individual, you know, mm-hmm. relationships and trust that we develop with the leaders of those organizations.
Yeah, it's amazing. So Jason has someone here who has a question.
Hi there. Thank you so much for coming, Jess Ossenheiler. My question was, it seemed like you were clear on your mission, you had trust in Nat, you had connections and ears to the ground, and that somehow enabled you to land on supporting infrastructure in 5 areas in 2 weeks. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more about what that process was like of choosing yeah. where to focus. I would imagine that there were many options on the table. Mm-hmm. So I was yep. interested a little bit more in that process.
Yeah, so everything is always a work in progress, right? So yeah, I mean, there's a whole myriad of different issues that we could have focused on. And I was very apprehensive of saying, okay, well, these are the things that we should do, right? Because I wasn't actually just trying to make the case that this is what we should do, but that if you want to kind of, talking like to philanthropy, these are some of the areas that are critical mm-hmm. towards, if we make some real progress here, that it would help to fundamentally mm-hmm. Create a situation where there's greater opportunity for Black communities to thrive. And so I had some things in my head, but like I said, I went to my partners on the ground, and actually one in particular that was really helpful was a group called BOLD, Black Organizers for Leadership and Dignity, Denise Perry. So Denise Perry was the executive director of Power U, a group that we funded, and I think that was, no, she didn't make dinner for us. Somebody made dinner. Anyway. But we had a long-standing relationship prior to this. And BOLD is an amazing organization. They fund they support and do deep training and support for Black organizers across the country. And it's one of the few organizations that does that. But because they're so connected to a broad swath of the organizations on the ground, they are there. They know. I think have a better sense of what the kind of key issues are on the ground. So the issues that we selected are really reflect the issues that BOLD chooses in terms of the cohorts and the issue cohorts that they are pulling from. And there's a couple others we threw in there, like mm-hmm. civic engagement. We thought that was important. but particularly because we were in the South. I mean, so it's not just those issue areas. We also have emphasis areas as well that we think it's critical to lift up and support black women's leadership and youth leadership within this, because if you're talking about black social change, black women and youth have always been at the center of that. Mm-hmm. We think the South is a critical area to support work in, because the majority of black people right now live in the South, but also because the persistent racial, social, and economic injustices that happen in the region. That is a key area to focus on. And so yeah, it was this collaboration, not just with BOLD, but again, as I went around and talked mm-hmm. to other organizers across the country as I was writing a paper, these were some of the things that they were saying were kind of key areas. Mm-hmm. So it is this kind of back and forth process. Mm-hmm. In a collaboration, there's a point where you still have to make a choice,
decide,
right?
Yeah.
And so that's what we chose. We have faith and confidence in that, mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that there aren't other issues. And like mm-hmm. I said earlier, the mm-hmm. ultimate goal of this network, what we really want to try to see is that across issue, across philanthropy, regardless of what you focus on, mm-hmm. that there is an increased commitment both in passion, but also in terms of investment for creating mm-hmm. opportunities to combat the structural barriers that are preventing black communities to thrive.
Great, thank you so much, Nat. Andy's got someone. Tell us who you are.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Jordan from the Ruth Mott Foundation in Flint, Michigan. Really appreciate the conversation. One of the things that I'm struck by is that you made the intentional decision, as is common in many foundations, that you've made a commitment to working for the advancement of a community that involves working across lines of class, of race, and very often, you know, the intentionality is there, the good intentions are always present, but sometimes when deciding to engage across those lines, the core competencies, the skills, the adaptive abilities aren't always necessarily in place to do that effectively. And I'm wondering, as you made that important decision of where your priorities were going to be, what sorts of processes did you go through to ensure that you had those right core competencies in place to be able to work effectively across those social mm-hmm. lines?
You want to take that first, Ashley?
Yeah.
I mean, I'll start, and then I'm going to throw it to Nat. I think we knew...
Well, the first decision was with
was
him,
hiring Nat, right?
Yeah.
So exactly. So when we were hiring Nat, I mean, we had actually, and even predating our hire of Nat, we'd been working with advisors at the Tides Foundation who came from backgrounds in community organizing and activism and had deep connections in those areas. So that was sort of the model that we were like baked in. So when we were looking to hire our first full-time staff member, we knew we wanted someone who had experience not just in philanthropy. We needed that because we were starting out, but we also wanted someone who had experience in community organizing. And I mean, that for us, mm-hmm. that was sort of the basic, like you actually needed someone who had done this work. That was mm-hmm. one very tangible way right. that we tried to make sure we had those capacities.
So as I said, there are different parts to our work. This latest initiative, this Making Black Lives Matter initiative, is the latest iteration of our work. But one of the core values that the foundation has is to both be a risk taker and to support work in underrepresented, under-resourced areas. And so that's part of what drives us, but we also realize that as we're doing that, as we select that to be kind of our reason, as our reason for being, that there are a number of capacity challenges within that. So with youth organizing, when we first started there, it was a fledgling field. There were organizations that were doing work, but they were very tiny. And so partnering with the Funders Collaborative for Youth Organizing, partnering with our other partners, we tried to figure out how to bring additional capacity to those groups. Again, it's not something necessarily that we did ourselves. We focus our dollars on grassroots organizing groups. All the groups we support, for the most part, have budgets under $1 million because, again, that is a part of the sector that typically is not focused on. But we realize if we can form partnerships with other folks that are picking up other aspects of that, then we could hopefully have a whole that's greater than the sum of its parts. And so similarly here, when we're talking about infrastructure and building infrastructure and the kind of constricted leadership pipelines in Black social change organizations, and this is new for us, we're gonna adopt the same approach. We're focusing on supporting Black-led organizing, and we are trying to partner with other organizations, other foundations that are taking other pieces of that. And hopefully, in our best efforts, we'll bring that all together to create an overall kaleidoscope of opportunity and capacity.
Mm-hmm. Great. So I'm going to take moderator's privilege real quick, Andy, before that person. So one of the pieces of feedback that we get when we talk about collaboration is, don't sanitize it. Don't make it sound like they're these easy steps, you know. Yep. And you guys are pretty darn impressive, and I think we're all getting lots of good wisdom. But I also want to hear you talk about your challenges. I know, Ashley, you talked about how you're still growing as a collaborator, and so it'd be great to talk a little bit about your missteps, your challenges.
Well, Matt mentioned that we have, in each of our three primary program areas, we have some collaborative effort attached, and also we fund 70% of our funding, philanthropic dollars, go to the South, despite the fact that none of us actually live in the South, but we felt like there was real need and opportunity, and that was a driving criteria for us early on. So I think we've, you know, had varying levels of success with those different collaborative efforts, right? So Nat mentioned the DC Social Justice Collaborative.
Yeah.
Like, we really wanted to generate support for social justice efforts in DC, and like, kind of didn't really go anywhere. There was a report, there were convenings, there were all sorts of stuff. Like, didn't really gain traction.
Why do you think that is?
That might just be like a really long conversation to talk about politics in the district.
All right, there's one thing. But is there anything that you feel like you had an oops-a-daisy about or you could have done differently?
Nat, maybe I'll turn to you, but I think we probably could have taken stock of some of those complexities and realities and who was out there, potential collaborators, before we sort of led the charge into this. I mean, I think that this work takes a really long time, and we have this model of sort of thinking that it'd be a good idea for people to collaborate, and we often, you know, seed some research or fund or collaborative or some combination, and we like throw this party, and sometimes people come. Sometimes they come, but they come like really, really late. Like, you're taking down the streamers and popping the balloons late. And you have to be comfortable dancing by yourself at your party for a while. And we've had, the Funders Collaborative on Youth Organizing, I think, is a really good example. You mentioned that Nat had been in a leadership role for 10 years there. And there was a lot of interest in like 2000 when it was founded. And in the intervening years, there's been some waning, some ups and downs, and Nat like essentially staffed the thing for some periods of time in there. And in recent years, there's been a resurgence of interest, and that's fantastic. But we, I was actually at your conference in the spring, the Learning Conference, and I was listening to the California Endowment folks talk about their
Manuel Pastor
talk about their Building Healthy Communities Initiative, $1 billion. Community youth organizing is at the center of this massive initiative, and there are literally slides with quotes from this report we funded in like 2004 that are 10 or 2000. I mean, it was like 15 years later that this stuff is kind of getting disseminated and out there. And I think you have to have a lot of patience and risk tolerance.
Yep, absolutely.
Well, I'll add that it takes a lot of people power and time. And we are a 2 full-time and 2 part-time staff operation. And frankly, in terms of the leveraging work, most of it falls to me. And so with DC, there just weren't that many funders who were already supporting or really even familiar with this ideal of social justice and community organizing. So we had to try to cultivate that. For instance, we didn't use community organizing when we were talking to them. We called it resident-led decision-making, right? We were trying to All right, you tried to, okay, yeah. So anyway, but there was a lot of work to be done there, but as I was doing that work, I was, I think at the same time, as Ashley said, helping to staff the Funders Collaborative Youth Organizing because the ED had left and there was a transition there. We were a couple of years later that after that trying to get the Grant Makers of Southern Progress off the ground, which I led. And so, you know, I was in some of the sessions. I was bouncing around, so I'm sorry if I left your session early today. but you know, they were really great. And reading the report, there are so many different things I learned just in that brief period of time about how to do collaborations successfully. I think what we put in the game is a whole bunch of skin, meaning that I put my time in, and you know I'm there driving it. And so there's a certain level of fragility in some of these collaborations, because when I couldn't devote the time, then work kind of waned, and I got back in and picked up. And so I think there really does have to be a commitment to not just trying to fill a space, but also to do that collaboratively with other partners and create an environment where those other partners step up. So not to have a collaborative in name only, but actually in practice, I think is really key. And that's something we've been struggling with, frankly.
It's a lot of push and pull there. Okay, great. Thank you for your patience, whoever is over here with Andy.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Beth Hertz, based at the Serdna Foundation. Thanks for sharing your stories this afternoon. So I want to go back to the conversation about Black Lives Matter and how you've been engaged in collaborating there. Sometimes we hear in movement building and organizing work the mantra that the revolution will not be funded. And I think it's interesting for a lot of good reasons. There's a lack of trust sometimes, or you hear skepticism about relying on foundation resources over time. We've seen in Occupy Wall Street and that movement, decentralization, and that's coming up again in the movement for Black Lives, that by nature, this movement is very decentralized. And so I'm curious, in that context, what have you been seeing, what perspectives have you been seeing in the movement for Black Lives, and how do you engage in collaboration in that context?
I've definitely heard the mantra, the movement will not be funded. I say the movement will not be funded completely by philanthropy, but the money that you do get, it's really helpful, right? And In many of the, but there's also, I think we need to expand our conception of what philanthropy is. Often we talk about institutional philanthropy, right? But donors have been really key to creating quickly mobilized resources in critical moments over the last year for the Black Lives Matter movement, particularly as it relates to bail bond funds and legal response and other types of things. Individual donors have been really helpful, both individuals of wealth and also using social media to communicate that. So you know, this ideal of the revolution won't be funded, there are other aspects to that as well. Within philanthropy, though, some foundations have really stepped up greatly, you know, and provided really critical support, both through new dollars, but also through supporting groups that were already there on the ground. I mean, I think that's one of the other misconceptions, is that the media, other folks have focused on newer organizations that have come up. And they are some amazing people. Many of them are on our first docket for Making Black Lives Matter initiative. But all this work happened in a broader context of Black-led organizing groups that have been doing work for years, right? And many of them have provided on the ground resources to these newer formations. And so I think that there is a real partnership that can be formed with respect. So you have to respect your role within that, but there's a real partnership that can be formed with mobilizing resources from philanthropic entities to support work in the moment, and more importantly, to build a long-term infrastructure. You know, we talk about, when we talk about this initiative, we're really talking about like a 50-100-year like horizon to create, rebuilding the infrastructure that will really not just create opportunities for the Black community to thrive, but for the nation to thrive overall. We do see this, that all boats rise with the same tide, but if someone's constantly under the boat. You know, it's just hard for that to happen. And so I do think that there's a lot of challenges with philanthropy operating the way it normally does and interfacing in these hierarchical modes with some of the newer groups out there. But I think that's something that we can work through. And part of what we're trying to do in this network is not just mobilize resources, but again, mobilize those relationships. Build a relationship so that you can actually have those conversations to figure out and to make sure that you are accountable to the needs of the groups that you're supporting rather than the needs of the way that you actually have to communicate your resources. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
No, I know
I got
great.
The 10 minutes.
And I,
right?
No, I would just add to that. I mean, we are sort of an issue agnostic community organizing funder, like social justice community organizing funder. We recognize that the communities that we're serving, you know, face multiple issues, and with making Black Lives Matter, we've really focused on the infrastructure piece because, well, some of the issue, you know, immediate policy victories are critical, like particularly around criminalization and police brutality, like they're getting press and we need to seize them. Those victories couldn't be sustained if we don't have a stronger infrastructure. So I think we've had this kind of tension with, not tension, but discussion certainly, as we've developed this initiative, you know, how much of this should be about seizing some of this low-hanging fruit and really trying to secure some important victories, and how much of this should be about building infrastructure for the, you know, 50-100-year time horizon. Mm-hmm. And I think we've basically come to the idea that some of those victories are important to build that infrastructure, but the end goal for us is that long-term infrastructure development. Mm-hmm.
So there's someone in the back who gets the final question, and then I'm going to ask them a wrap-up.
The pressure is on.
Yeah, no pressure.
I'm Susan Misra. I'm with the Management Assistance Group. And I'm really struck by just how you have such a strong awareness and understanding of justice, equity, and power, and the coherency that you've built both internally and then through your actions externally as you collaborate in bringing that awareness forward. And I'm wondering what you've learned about how to work with funding partners who either don't have that same awareness and understanding or don't have the capacity to have the same coherency between their staff and their board and the work that they're doing.
Well, let me just give a different example. So as Kathleen said, we were instrumental in helping to start a group called Grantmakers of Southern Progress that's trying to bring Southern funders and national funders together to really support more structural change and social justice funding in the South. And we did this report, and what we found was that, you know, people were, national funders and Southern funders were talking past one another, right? And they had really bad relationships when they did actually talk together. In trying to figure out how to bridge those gaps, we started talking differently to different groups. And what we found out over the last few years is that we've done a decent job, along with other kind of environmental factors, of helping to lift up the need and awareness of supporting or getting grant makers to support structural change work in the South, right? But the last part of that, the progress part, is actually where it gets really tricky. How do you define progress, and how do you move folks from where they are to where you may want them to be or where I think we may need to be to really talk about dealing with structural inequity, racial inequity, and economic dislocation? And that's been a particular challenge for us. And so I think when you don't have a clarity around where you want to go, and I think that's what we're trying to build within that space right now. What is not just what does progress mean, but how can progress help create an environment of prosperity for us all? We're trying to figure that out within that space. And it's a constant process of going back and having conversation and relationship building. And it's tough, but I think you have to start from a place of sometimes letting the experience get you to a place where you know what questions you actually even need to ask.
And I would just add that I think we do that as well. I know you're trying to wrap us up. With other family foundations and who are interested in but concerned about engaging in social justice work. And so as trustees, we'll have individual mm-hmm. conversations and relationships to talk about just our experience mm-hmm. doing this work with a board that is candidly, you know, ideologically not necessarily all on the same page. Mm. So I think we try to kind of use the best messenger for the message, and mm. we have a bunch of us who can carry whatever the message is.
That's fantastic. I want to thank everyone out there for doing such a great job asking fantastic questions of these folks. I have one final one for you guys, which is, you know, if you were thinking about a parting piece of advice or reflection that you wanted to share with these folks, or it could be a request for help on something that you're still grappling with.
Or both, right?
Well, you know, in a minute.
Yes.
What would that seconds. Be? Ashley, I'm going to ask you to go first.
I was just looking at my notes, like, what haven't I covered? I mean, I think that for us to be able to do the work well, and I think most of the time we do the work well, and sometimes it doesn't mm-hmm. have the results we'd like, and sometimes it does, and sometimes it does years later, we've had to be very clear about who we are and how we operate and what our values are, and that has, you know, continues to evolve over time, and I think we continue to grapple with internal policy decisions or strategy decisions about our work that help us solidify those values, mm-hmm. but we wouldn't be able to collaborate as effectively if we weren't pretty clear when we go into these conversations mm-hmm. with who we are and what our agenda is mm-hmm. and to look for commonality with others without kind of being, without compromising mm-hmm. what we're trying to achieve. And all of that, to the point Nat made at the very beginning, is based on kind of openness and truly mm-hmm. long-term partnership. Mm-hmm. This is very much a people business that we're in, mm-hmm. and whether it's how we work internally in the trust we have among the board, between mm-hmm. board and staff, or with our grassroots partners who are doing the work, we rely on that kind of two-way street relationship. Mm-hmm. We get information that they're doing the work. Mm-hmm. We're providing them resources, and we are trying to support them so that they can more effectively do their work through grant dollars and a host of other mm-hmm. things. But you know, for us, it's really about the respect that they deserve for doing the work that mm-hmm. we don't do. Mm-hmm.
So one, I just want to say thank you so much for allowing us to share a little bit of our story here today. I am so excited by this conference and the mm-hmm. focus, and not just the focus of the conference, but how deeply each one of you in this room is trying to grapple with this ideal, with this practice of how to engage better, mm-hmm. More strategically with our partners so that we can create the type of change we want to see. And so that's just amazingly exciting mm-hmm. And heartening. And so for folks who want to learn more about some of the work that we're doing in the South or some of the work that we're doing right now around creating opportunities for Black communities to thrive, definitely get in touch with me. But I think that as we look at collaboration, as we look at partnership, we need to adopt a vision that is not about just transactions, right? We have an opportunity in this moment by the work that you're doing, by different things that have happened, the Black Lives Matter movement, whatever, other opportunities to look for how philanthropy can be transformed, and in being transformed, how we can help the transformation that's happening in our communities. But we can't stop at the kind of just regular way that we've been doing business. We do have to push ourselves. We have to be bold and courageous and innovative and take the risk that we need to really set a goal of transformation as opposed to just change. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I would leave you with. How do we push ourselves to make sure that we're supporting transformation along the pathway of change?
That's so fantastic. You know, their story, you're already with the applause. I was going to just lift up a couple of the themes that were coming up in this rich story that are so connected to what we're all trying to figure out about how to be true collaborators, how to build a culture of collaboration. And there are just so many, I wish I was tweeting right now because there were so many tweetable moments. you know, about governance. It was about sharing power and the loss, you know, facing up to the loss that's required to do that. I mean, that is strong, important stuff. The board spends time to get that street level view, to really know the advocates that they're supporting so that they're best prepared to govern. And there are no bright lines between board and staff. The staff invites the board invites the staff in, and those all seem pretty powerful. From a values perspective, the one that struck me the most about being mission first was, we're not in the business of endowment preservation. I loved that sentiment because that really means you're gonna do what the work requires and put the mission first. And then the other piece that you said, Nat, about the intrinsic worth of partners. Mm-hmm. He slipped it in on the front end, but there's something so profound about that, you know, that this is not, you know, a transactional situation, that there's just an intrinsic worth of being with those folks. And how you go about it is through field leadership and leveraging and long-term support and flexible support and a lot of threads that I think you'll find in the GEO publications and a lot of the characteristics that you're gonna find back there on all the gingerbread men that you guys all built. So please join me in deeply thanking Nat and Ashley for sharing their story with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
So next, y'all are off for a little break and then the case study conversation. So enjoy. We'll see you back here tomorrow.